Okay, so last time we talked a bit about these boost field localizations where we keep the same cofibrations and we enlarge the set of weak equivalences. And while I stated that there is one on one reduced simplicial sets where the weak equivalences are rational equivalences, so maps of simplicial sets that induce isomorphisms on homotopy groups censored with Q. And this provides us with a cofibrantly generated model category. And we can also describe explicitly the fibrant objects, which were Ken complexes with rational homotopy groups. Okay. These are the models of our model category. And our goal is to find a model category which is even more algebraic than this category. For example, like we did, well, we did it very briefly, but for simplicial abelian groups, we had simplicial abelian groups, which are, well, still simplicial stuff, so not completely algebraic, and they are Quillian equivalent to chain complexes, which are, well, at this point, it's completely algebraic. It's just a bunch of vector space and planar maps, which are easier to handle than simplicial abelian groups. But for rational simplicial sets, it will not be as simple as just simplicial abelian groups. In fact, we'll have to go through this category of commutative differential graded algebras, which is not an abelian category. So we have this whole non-abelian homotopy theory going on. All right. So there is a question, why is rational homotopy more discriminant than rational cohomology? And we get examples. We will get examples a bit later on. So it's possible for, it's possible for two spaces to have the same rational cohomology, but not be rationally homotopy equivalent. Just like it's possible for two spaces to have the same singular cohomology and not be homotopy equivalent, right? But even for rational cohomology, even with this theorem of Serre that a map is an equivalence on rational homotopy, if and only if it is one on rational cohomology, you can still find counterexamples. I will give one a bit later on, but I want to introduce some stuff before. So it exists, but bear with me before I give the examples. Okay, so for today, we will do some stuff about these commutative differential gradient algebras and introduce this notion of transferred model structures, which is very useful. Very often, you will have some adjunction between model categories and a model structure on one, and the transferred model structure will be used to transfer it along the adjunction. There is another question. In Serre, the cohomology is considered degree-wise. Yes, I mean, well, so let's look back at the theorem. We are looking at the induced map on cohomology. If it is an isomorphism of vector spaces, then it is an isomorphism of rings because it is a map of rings. So you can just check that it is an isomorphism of vector spaces. But if it is an isomorphism of vector spaces, then it is an isomorphism of rings. But this is a useful observation because, maybe not in this exact setting, but it's often useful. For example, you want to compute the cohomology. You know that you only need to compute it as a vector space and not as a ring. So you can find some complex, which is not a ring, and compute it like that. And you can do things like this. It depends on your particular needs. So I was saying, yeah, you have these model structures that are transferred along adjunctions. So the one we are going to see is I never remember. It's the right transferred model structure. It's much easier than the left transferred model structure, essentially because this one deals with cofibrantly generated model categories. And the other one would deal with fibrantly generated model categories, which are classical model categories of algebras are not vibrantly generated, they are co-vibrantly generated. All right, so let's start with commutative differential graded algebras, which I will always abbreviate as CDGA, much shorter. Okay, so these are models for cohomology rather than homology. So we will deal with co-chain complex rather than chain complex. So just to recall you, a co-chain complex, well, we will only deal with non-negatively graded over Q is a collection of Q vector spaces V. Just to emphasize that we are dealing with co-chain complex, I will put all the indices on the top, equipped with linear maps D from Vn to Vn plus one, such that D circle D is zero. Okay. And we denote by CH with an upper zero Q the category, right? And you can, I'm sure you know what the morphisms are. Okay. So this, what I'm going to say in what follows depends pretty heavily on the fact that we are dealing with a vector with a field of characteristic zero. If we had a ring, which was not a field, or even a field of positive characteristic, many of the things I'm going to say will not work. I will point out where it goes wrong, basically. Well, there are essentially two things that go wrong over rings or fields of positive characteristics. First is that, well, you have a QNF formula, which doesn't work. You have to do a whole thing about Tor and so there is this issue. And the second thing is that the algebras we are looking at are commutative. And so we have some action of a symmetry group going on. And the symmetry group is a finite group and it has an order. And if the order of your field divides the order of your symmetric group, which happens as soon as the symmetry group is big enough, then you have an issue on cohomology. So that's why it's important here that we are working over a field of characteristic zero, and why rational homotopy theory works much better than, well, for example, F2 homotopy theory or even Z homotopy theory. Okay, to have some notation, the degree, I will often denote it as degree of A. And sometimes, just to have shorter formulas, I will write it like this, just to have a shorter formula. And whenever I write this, then it means that I'm looking at homogeneous elements, not inhomogeneous elements. All right. So, another definition, a differential graded algebra, for short DGA, is a co-chain complex A equipped with a linear map. Well, several linear maps actually. So mu from A tensor A into A, so a bilinear map from A to cross A into A, and a unit like this. Such that, well, we have two conditions. we have associativity. So if we start from A, we can apply mu on the first factor or mu on the second factor, and then apply mu again. So this is associativity. Essentially, it tells you that ABC is equal to ABC. Okay. And it's unital, so you have two axioms. So if you insert the unit on the left, on the right, and you apply the multiplication, then you get the identity. So this means that A times 1 is 1 times A, where 1 is eta. So a degree zero cocycle. Okay. So this is just a graded algebra. And I said I would introduce differential graded algebra. So we have also Leibniz relation. Well, I can write it as as a commutative diagram, but since there are some signs. So the differential of a product is given by this formula. You apply the differential on the first factor and you apply the differential on the second factor. But whenever you do this, you have a sign like this. Okay, and I didn't say it, but for notation, A times B here is sent to AB. All right. So you have this Leibniz relation and you have a sign here, which is pretty characteristic of differential graded stuff. Well, you can think about it this way. You have this element D that is of degree 1, and you have this element A that is of degree of A. And here in this formula, to get from here to here, you have swapped D and A, right? You have, and so whenever you have a switch like this, then you multiply by a sign, which is the minus 1 to the power of the degree of the two elements multiplied. So here, D is of degree 1, so this degree doesn't appear, and you just keep the degree of A, all right? So an example of a differential graded algebra, you have the singular cochains on a space with, well, probably with Q coefficients because I want to do it over Q. This is a differential graded algebra. Right. Also, the cohomology of a space is a differential graded algebra. It has a differential equal to 0. Voilà. Maybe some quick lemma. If A is a DDA, and so is its cohomology, zero differential. Essentially, this follows from this formula. If you have two cocycles, then their product will be a cocycle. And if you multiply a cocycle by a coboundary, then the product is a coboundary. All right. So let me maybe write it this way. So first, you have to check that you just have to check that the product is well defined. But if DA is DB is 0, and D of AB is 0 by this formula. So the product sends cocycles to cocycles. And moreover, if DA equals 0 and B is DC, then A times B is A times DC. is, well, here you have a sign, minus one, degree of A, D of AC. So it's well defined on cohomology classes. If you have two elements which are coordinate, well, then their product will be coordinate. They will essentially, if you multiply something by a coboundary and this something is a co-cycle, here I use that this thing here vanishes in the formula, then you get a coboundary at the end. Okay. Standard stuff. Now we get to commutative DGA. So commutative DGA, which I will abbreviate as CDGA, is a DGA such that for all AB in A, B times A is minus one to the power B times A times B. Okay, so don't be fooled by the name. The commutative doesn't mean that we have an actual commutativity, because you have every time you have these signs that appear. So, example, the cohomology of a space is a CDGA. But the singular cochains are not a CDGA because the product is not graded commutative. It's only graded commutative up to coboundary. Maybe you know this, but this is not a CDGA. There is an operation which is called the cup one product, that satisfies such a relation whenever. So either I assume that A and B are co-cycles, or I can add, let's say, if T equals zero. So this tells you that this cup product is only commutative up to commandary. So one of the points of rational homotopy theory is also to find a replacement for this which is actually commutative and which is quasi-isomorphic to this. And this is something that we can actually only do for rational numbers. To my knowledge, there is not really, it's much more complicated if it's not rational. You have to go through this whole theory of E infinity algebra that I'm not going to talk about at all. But be aware that it exists. Let me remark some stuff that is it's obvious from the definition, but it's good to point out. If the degree of A is odd, then A square is equal to minus A square from this equation. And so therefore, A square is equal to zero. And let me remark that this works because we are over a field of characteristic zero. If we were over a field of characteristic two, then we could not conclude anything about A square. If the degree of A is even, this is obvious, but I want to write it explicitly, then for all B, AB is equal to BA, even if B is odd. Because whenever you have something multiple of two here, then this is one. Right. Okay. Any questions so far? All right. So our goal is, it will be the following. First, we are going to put a model structure on the category of CDGAs. So to do this, we are going to use this transferred model structure theory. And then once we have done this, we are going to prove that there is some Quillen adjunctions with simplicial set, much later. And so to transfer the model structure of co-chain complexes. So we are going to see, and essentially this is what we did in chapter one, but there is a model structure on this one, and it doesn't really matter if it's projective or injective because over a field, well, everything is projective and injective. So there is a model structure here, and we want to transfer it to CDGA. And to do this, we need to have an injunction, and this injunction will be given by the free CDGA functor. And so the goal is to start from a co-chain complex and build the free CDGA on it, which is, will be something that gives a left adjoint to a forgetful functor. So maybe something obvious. There exists a forgetful functor . Well, you just take a CDGA and you forget it's a CDGA, you just remember that it is a co-chain complex, and it becomes a functor pretty much by definition. So our goal will be to find a left adjoint to this functor. So there is a whole intuition behind how to find left adjoints to functor. Essentially, well, you want something that preserves co-limits. So, well, you try to write everything here as a co-limit of simple stuff, and you try to guess what's the free stuff on one generator, for example, and then you take co-limits of these and try to build the functor on the whole thing. So let me give you the final answer to this. So let V be a co-chain complex. The symmetry group so I will write it with a French notation. Sigma n acts on V tensor n. A transposition. So it's a bit annoying to write down the explicit action. Essentially, I want to have this action. So when two elements are swapped, then you introduce a sign, which is the product of minus one to the product of their degrees. But when you have many elements, you need to count how many things there are, but only if the things that you swap are odd degree, and if they are even degree, then you don't count. So it's a bit annoying. So I will just say how it acts, how transpositions act. So the transposition that swaps I and I plus one acts by, so you take V1 tensor Vn, and this is a right action. Well, doesn't really matter, but it's minus one Vi plus one V1, blah, 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 Vi minus two, Vi minus one. No, sorry, I did it wrong. Vi plus one, Vi plus two, and then you continue. So whenever you have two elements and you want to swap them, then you introduce this sign, and this extends to the symmetry group, which, as you know, is generated by this sigma I with the relation sigma I square is one. And well, sigma I, sigma j is sigma j, sigma I if you have this, and sigma I, sigma I plus one, sigma I, sigma I plus one, sigma I, sigma I plus one for all I. All right, this is a classical presentation of the symmetry group. It's generated by transpositions, and you have these relations. I will need to check that these relations are actually satisfied pretty much immediate. Because I'm lazy, sometimes instead of writing this sign, I will write plus or minus. some people don't like this, but well, it's usually you can know what the sign is. You just see what elements were swapped and you count the signs and you get the proper sign. I will try to write the explicit signs all the time, but well, sometimes it's a bit pointless, I think. All right. So you have this action, okay? So someone is asking if we are going to use this formula in calculus for other things than the left adjoint proof. Yes, well, which formula, this one? Sine? Or this one? Ah, well, yes, I mean, but in some sense, yes. I mean, as soon as you have a commutative differential gradient algebra, then this action is in the background. But it's not a certain thing that this is something difficult. It's just when you want to swap, to permute elements in a product, and there is a sign that appears, and how do you get this sign? Well, you see how to go. For example, if you want to go from A, B, C, D, which is not the differential, to D, A, C, B, how do you do it? Well, you just swap B and C, and then you swap B with everything. So what do you get? Well, you get minus one B, C, times minus one D with A plus B plus C. That's it. That's all this thing does. You just see how to get from one product to the other and you get a sign. And since these expressions can become complicated rather quickly, sometimes I will write just plus or minus D, A, C, B. Implicitly, this means that the sign is obtained by this rule. All right. Okay. Some other definition that I need. Let V be Q vector space and G a group acting on V. The co-invariants are, so the classical notation is this one, you put V and you put G as an index. It's the quotient of V by some relation where it is generated by V is in relation with its action by an EG. Okay. So you just take a quotient where you identify some element with its orbit. It's the space of orbits of G. All right, so now let V be a cochain complex. The symmetric algebra on V is, so my notation for this is S of V. Sometimes you can find lambda of V. Well, why is there these two notations? It's because this symmetric algebra contains at the same time some kind of thing which is symmetric. When you have even degree elements, they commute. But when you have odd degree elements, then they anti-commute. So it's more like the exterior algebra. So the two things are a bit mixed inside. So, well, the two notations exist. So as a vector space, it's simply the direct sum like this. So you take V to the power R and you take the invariance, co-invariance under the action of the symmetric groups. So whenever you have two tensors which are obtained one from the other by a permutation of factors, then they are identified up to a sign. All right. So this is a graded vector space. The degree is just the sum of the degrees in a tensor, an elementary tensor. And the differential is given by Leibniz rule. So D of V1 Vn. Well, okay. So I will write it as a tensor first. It's a sum for I equals 1 to n. So you just sum over all possible ways of putting D on one of the vectors. All right, but when you do this, well, you have this D here, which was in the first position, and now it becomes in the position just after V I minus one. So whenever you have something like this, you must add a sign, and this sign is given by, so formula is a bit, okay. I will write minus one to the power epsilon where epsilon I is minus one, and I already put the minus one. It's simply the degree of V1 plus blah, 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 plus Vi minus one. All right, because you have switched an element of degree one with this thing here, which is of degree this. So the sign is minus one to the power one times the degree of these elements. All right. It's always the same idea. And the product mu, which goes from S of V tensor S of V to S of V, is induced by mu of V1 tensor Vn. And if you want to multiply it with W1 tensor Wm, and you just put the two things together. All right, and the unit is, well, eta you go to the zero tensor power. The zero tensor power is just Q. And you have the action of sigma zero, which is of course trivial, included in S of V. Okay, so it's just the empty tensor. The empty tensor is the unit for this product. All right. So it's a bit of a complicated definition maybe, but it's not that bad. What's the idea behind this definition? You start with, let's say we just have a vector space, no differential, no grading. You want to produce the free commutative algebra on it. Well, you take all possible formal products of elements of your vector space, and you model by the action that makes element commute. Right? So it's kind of like a polynomial algebra. Here you have more things. You have these signs. So they are in the action of sigma r on V tensor R. And you have a differential, and this differential, well, if you want the product to be given like this, and if you want the differential to satisfy the Leibniz formula, then the differential has to be this. All right. If you want D of a product to be D of the first plus D of the second, then you have to have this formula. All right. So concretely, S of V as an algebra is isomorphic to the polynomial algebra on even degree elements. Well, not really. As a vector space, tensor V exterior algebra on odd degree elements. Because in your algebra, even degree elements commute with each other, and odd degree elements anti-commute. So here you have some kind of polynomial algebra. Here you have an exterior algebra. Yes, I mean Q. Yeah. All right, and here this is a Q. All right, and now elements from this commute with elements of this, because even degree elements commute with everyone. And the differential is it's the differential induced from V using the Leibniz relation. All right. Oh. So as a proposition, this induces an adjunction where S is the left adjoint and the forgetful functor is the right adjoint. Okay. the proof is just, if you have already seen, if you know what an adjunction is, then surely you know that classical examples of adjunction include free algebra, free polynomial algebra, and so on. It's exactly the same proof. Whenever you have a map, a cochain map from V into some CDGA, you want to extend it uniquely to S of V, like that. And how do you do it? Well, you just put phi of V1 blah, Vn to be f of V1 times blah, times f of Vn. And you check that this defines, that this is well-defined and that this defines the morphism of CDGAs. Okay. If you have seen adjunctions before, then this will not surprise you at all. All right, so any questions so far? Right. So as a corollary, if you have the symmetric algebra on a direct sum, which is the coproduct in cochain complex, and this is isomorphic to the tensor product, which is the coproduct in CDGAs. Maybe I should say that here we have a pretty simple description for S of V. This is because we are working in commutative algebras. And here the coproduct is the tensor product, also because we are working in commutative algebras. If we were in non-commutative algebras, then the coproduct is something much larger. If you have already seen what a free group is, for example, then you know how big this thing can get. So another proposition, if you take some cochain complex V, you take its symmetric algebra and you take its cohomology, and V should be isomorphic to the symmetric algebra on the cohomology of V for all V in CH of Q. So this follows from two statements. The first one is the QNF formula. So proof, you have the QNF formula, which tells you that the cohomology of V times W is cohomology of V tensor cohomology of W. And this works because Q is a field. So if you go back to the definition of a symmetric algebra, you have the cohomology of this. But now you need to deal with the co-invariance. And the proof is the following: if G is a finite group, then the cohomology of VG is isomorphic to the cohomology of VT. And this is the proof that only works for characteristic zero fields. All right, so this one you have probably seen before. This one maybe is new. So you have a canonical quotient map like this. So the quotient map induces a map like this, which you can check induces something like this. Right, so you have to be a bit careful with the notation. What is an element here? It's something which is it's a cohomology class in the co-invariance of V. So it's something which is a co-cycle up to action of G, and it's a co-boundary up to action of G. Whereas here, you take a cohomology class in V, so something which is actually a co-cycle, you look it up to co-boundaries, actual co-boundaries, and then you have an action of G, which is, probably I should have said it, the action has to be compatible with a differential in the sense that dV times G is d V times G, otherwise it doesn't make sense. And then you have this action of G on the cohomology, and you take the co-invariance of this, right? So these are two different things, but in characteristic zero, they are actually equal because you can find an inverse morphism. So let's call this one pi and this one I. You will take one over the cardinality of G. Like this. Well, no, like this. Right. So you take some element here, which is a cocycle up to action of G, and which is well defined only up to co-boundary up to action of G. Right. And what you do is you take the sum over all possible, over all the orbit of G, of X under G. And now this is a well-defined cohomology class in V. And you take its class inside the co-invariance of V. Okay. And you divide by the cardinality of the group, because otherwise, if you do it like this, it will not give you the identity. It will give you multiplication by the cardinality. All right. And you can check that pi circle I is the identity, and I circle pi is the identity. Okay. But there is something important here, is that we were able to divide by the order of D. And you can only do this if the characteristic does not divide the order of D. So this is why also working over a field of characteristic zero is very important. All right. So any questions? This isomorphism is not true in positive characteristic. If P divides the order of D, then you have some extra term given by, I want to say, some Torr functor over Z of G or something like this. So we are really using that Q is of characteristic zero. All right, so any questions so far? So, all right, this is almost over with a background on CDGAs. Now, one last definition that I'm going to use a bit later on. A CDGA is called quasi-free if its underlying CGA, so the thing that has no differential, is free, has commutative graded algebra. So it's something that is, when you forget the differential, it's of the type S of V, but the differential can be more complicated. Okay. So for example, you can take, consider A, which is, I will write it like this. P of y is x square. Ah, it doesn't work. All right, so let me start giving examples of CDGAs, and I will always denote my examples like this. So here you have the generators as a CGA. The degree of x is 2. This is what I mean by this index 2. The degree of y is 3. Okay. And the differential is the unique map, linear map, D from S of V to S of V, such that D satisfies the Leibniz relation, and D restricted to V is as prescribed. So here we have dy is x squared in S of V, and dx is 0. Okay, maybe I can write it explicitly for this time. All right. So let me explain what I just wrote. So I want to define a CDGA. So I need to define, a cochain complex, a product, and a differential. So for the cochain complex, and actually for the graded vector space, I take the underlying graded vector space of this CDGA on these generators which have no differential. And the product is the product of the symmetric algebra. But then I want to define a differential, and I just need to define it on generators, because just like, so I will go back up a bit, just like there exists a unique linear map, which is a product of algebra given a map on generators, there also exists a unique linear map which satisfies the Leibniz relation when you give it on generators. Because if you want to compute D of V1, Vn, well, you have this relation from before, V1, Vi minus 1, dVi, Vi plus 1, Vn. And this one is D restricted to the generators, so an element of this. So whenever you have a map D given on generators, so this gives a map D from S of V to S of V. Okay. Okay. So concretely, in our case, just to give a very concrete example, in our case, as a vector space, A is spanned by, so you have a unit, you have X, you have Y, you have X square. You do not have Y square because Y square is zero because y is odd, right? So you still have xy. And okay, maybe I can swap these two. Xy, x square. You also have x square times y, but you still don't have x square times y square because y square is zero. Then you have x cube times y, and so on. Okay. And the degree as follows. This is a degree 0, 2, 3, 2 plus 3, 5, degree 4. Okay, they are not in the correct order. X squared times y is of degree 7. X cube is of degree 6. This is of degree 6 plus 3, 9, and so on. Okay, so this is as a vector space. For the product, well, you just multiply elements. So if you multiply, for example, xy with x, and you get x squared times y. If you multiply xy with y, you get zero, because y times y is zero. Okay, and finally, the differential will simply be defined by this equation, knowing that d of y is x squared and d of x is zero. So for example, d of one, well, it must be zero because it's always the case. Yeah. So why is y squared equal to zero? It's because it's an odd generator. It's something I remarked a bit earlier. If you have A, which is odd, any odd element, then using this relation, A, you take B equals A in this relation, you take, and then you get A times A is equal to minus 1 A times A. So A squared is equal to minus A squared, so it's 0. All right, so in our case, as a vector space, we only have these elements. Then the differential is given like this. D of one is zero. So let me also remark that this is always the case, right? D of one times one is D one times one plus one times D one. So in the end, you get, one times one is one. So you get D of one is equal to D of one plus D of one. So D of one is zero. So this is the case no matter what. All right, then dx is zero. Dy is, we said it was x squared. And for example, if we want to compute d of xy, you have the Leibniz relation. So this is dx times y plus, and it's a plus because you swap d with x. So one and two, so this is minus one to the square. X times dy. So dx is 0, dy is x squared, so this is x cubed. Then you can continue. D of x squared is dx times x plus x times dx, so this is 0. D of x squared times y is what? Is d of x squared times y plus x times dx. Oh, okay, sorry. I didn't cut in the correct place. Dx times xy plus x times dx times y plus x times dy. So only the last term is non-zero. So in the end, you get x times dy, which is x squared. So you get x to the power 4 and so on. Okay, maybe to put everything in the same page, you get something like this. Okay, so the differential, if I want to write it down, this goes to this, this one goes to this one goes to something that would be here and so on. So you just, in cohomology, you will only keep one and x. And everything after will vanish in cohomology. Either it's a cobondary or it's not a cocycle. Okay. So any questions so far? So this is a very typical way of defining a CDG, right? You define the generators. You give them some degree and you define a differential. So this is a, sorry, I should have said a quasi-free CDGA. All right, this is my definition. CDGA is quasi-free. If you give some generators, you have no relations on the product, but you have a differential. Okay, so someone is asking, I don't understand your last sentence on cohomology. So I'll say it again. In cohomology, the cohomology of A will be, you have Q if star is 0, Q if star is 2, and 0 otherwise. Because, well, in degree 0, you have 1, in degree 2, you have x, and in degree 3, this is not a cocycle, so nothing. In degree 4, you just have x squared, but x squared is the cobondary of this. So not zero in cohomology. In degree 5, this is not a cocycle. In degree 6, you have this, but not a cobondary, and so on. So everything will vanish in a higher degree. So this is the cohomology of S2, in fact. Which, well, I'm getting a bit ahead of myself, but this is Q of x mod x squared. So we are going to see later, there is actually some kind of algorithm to start from this and to get to a quasi-free CDGA, which has the same cohomology like that. But well, we are going to see it only later. All right, so any questions so far? No? Okay, so it's time for a little 5 minutes break. So we just pause. Okay, all right, so we have this whole preliminaries on CDGAs. Now the goal is to use this functor, the symmetric functor, to produce a model structure on CDGAs. Right. So I guess we can put this transferred model structures. Right. So let me first remind you. So there is a Co-vibrantly generated model structure on CH at least zero of Q, where W are quasi-isos, vibrations are surjections, and co-vibrations are injections in degree strictly greater than zero. And the generating co-vibrations are, well, these elements. So I will define these things. And is at least zero, and J and at least also zero, where SN of Q is just zero everywhere except in degree n, and dn of Q is zero everywhere except in degree n minus one and n. Right. It's not Sn minus one. Well, depends what you call Sn minus one. But if you put Q in degree n here, and you put Q in degree n minus one and n here, then in order to have the inclusion, you need to send it to the degree n, because now the differential go up in degree. So if you want to have a commutative diagram, if this is degree n minus one and n, you need to have something. Oh, yes, you are right. You need to have something in the correct degree. No, it was correct. Yeah, you have to have n here, because this commutes if you put it in degree n, but if you put it in degree n minus one, it doesn't commute here. So you need to send this Q to this Q and not this one. Yeah, for chain complexes it's different, but here everything is reverse. So you have a slight difference. Also there is a special case, which is a D0. So D0 of Q is a Q in degree zero and then zero everywhere. All right. So the proof is just, is the same as for what we did in chapter one. It's easier because we don't have to think about projective complexes and so on, because over a field, everything is at the same time injective and projective. So no issues at all. It's exactly the same proof. You do the small object argument and you get a co-vibrantly generated models category. Okay. So we have this model structure on chain complexes, and we want to transfer it in some sense to CDGAs. So what do I mean by transfer? So it's as follows. So let F from D to C U be an adjunction, and assume C is a model category. So just from the notation, U is supposed to make you think about a forgetful functor, and F is supposed to make you think about a free functor. So this is exactly the situations we have above, We have a forgetful functor from chain complexes, and we have a free functor from CDG. The other way around, forgetful into chain complexes and a free functor into CDGs. The write transferred model structure on D. and it's as usual, right? Maybe it doesn't exist. So if it exists, is given by WD is U minus one sorry, I inverted C and D. We want to transfer to the right, so we want to transfer the one from the left to the right. Okay, so the weak equivalences on C are given by maps which are weak equivalences in D when you forget the structure. You can think about it like this. And vibrations in C are maps which are vibrations in D when you forget the structure. All right. And cofibrations in C are maps which have the left elliptic property with respect to this. Okay, so you have a model structure here and you want to transfer it to the right, and for this you use this functor U. Right, so you say that something here is a weak equivalence or a vibration if it is one when you forget using U some structure that you could have. Okay, so our goal is to use it for this adjunction. Okay. But of course, maybe this structure doesn't exist. So there is a theorem which tells you that under some hypothesis, then there is actually a right transfer model structure. So this is a theorem which is again due to Quillen. Well, a lot of results I'm talking about in this course are due to Quillen. If D is cofibrantly generated by I and J so we have a bunch of conditions. So I will put it in a list like this. So D is cofibrantly generated by I and J. The sources of morphisms in I and J are small. All right, I will simplify compared to what's in my notes. The actual hypothesis is a kappa compact for some ordinal kappa, but you can think about just small. So C has to be complete and co-complete, of course. And finally, one of these two conditions is satisfied. So this is, of course, the hard part. Huh? The first things are, well, pretty much all the time. Either so if something has a left lifting property with respect to vibrations, vibrations are defined like this, remember, then it is a weak equivalence in C, all right? Which is well, something that you would expect from a model category. If you have something which is which has a left lifting property with respect to vibrations, then it is an acyclic cofibrations, and therefore it is a weak equivalence. So in practice, this is hard to check. So it's not the one we check. It's actually this one. For all A in C, for all X into Y in J, our cofibrillary, our generating acyclic cofibration, the map, which is given by the push out like this into F of Y is belongs to WC. All right. So if you take a generating acyclic cofibration and you have a push out like this, what am I writing? Nonsense. So map like this, of course. Let's assume that you have a push out like this. All right, and so you have a canonical map from A into the push out. And if the adjunction were a Coulomb equivalence, then this map would be the image of an acyclic cofibration under left adjoint. So it would be an acyclic cofibration, and acyclic cofibration are stable under pushout. So this map would be an acyclic cofibration. So if we have a model structure which is the right transferred and therefore by definition the adjunction is a Coulomb adjunction, then this has to be an acyclic cofibration. So the theorem tells you that all you need to check is that it is a weak equivalence, right? Then automatically, the right transferred model structure on C exists. And well, this is obvious, but this is a Quillen adjunction. Okay, because by definition, U preserves vibration and acyclic vibrations, because this is the definition of weak equivalences and vibration. So why don't we do that for simplicial sets and top? I guess we kind of did, kind of. This is almost what we did, because here the forgetful functor would be a singular set. It's a bit complicated because then you would need to define a weak equivalence. Which way is it? How does the injunction go? You have this. So this would be U. This is simply that the adjunction is the wrong way around, right? Here we have a model structure here, and we transfer it here. But here we have a model structure on the other side. You see, here we transfer from the left to the right. But in this case, the adjunction would transfer from the right to the left. So it's not, we cannot apply this theorem. Which other adjunction? What adjunction? No, but in this adjunction, we have a left and a right adjoint, okay? And the theorem is about when you have a model structure on this category and you want to transfer it to the right, so to C. So in this adjunction, D would be S set and top would be C. But the problem is that we don't have a model structure on D, we have it on C. So we cannot transfer. Here we would need some kind of a left transfer structure, which is something very different. You need a vibrantly generated model categories and so on. It's very different. Yeah. So there is something called the left transfer model structure. You can, well, I will let you try to guess the definition. It's not that bad. The problem is that to actually have the existence of this structure, you need either you need vibrantly generated model categories, but top is not vibrantly generated, so it doesn't work. Or you have stronger conditions that are harder to show. There are some recent papers on this, like from 3 or 5, 4 years ago, but it's much harder, right? Yes, if we had a model structure on simply solved sets, then we could transfer it to top. But the problem is that it's the other way around. So yeah, so this doesn't work. We kind of transfer the model structure from top to simply solved sets because, well, it's a bit complicated because weak equivalences are defined using the geometric realization. Vibrations are not, but vibrations are characterized by geometric realization. So, well, it's kind of a transfer model structure, but it's a very special case. For a general theorem, you need very strong assumptions. Okay, so as a corollary, the transferred model structure on CDGA exists. So weak equivalences are quasi-isos, and vibrations are surjections. All right, but co-fibrations are complicated. All right. This is also a feature of, something to think about for transferred model structures. You know weak equivalences, you know vibrations. Typically, it's difficult to describe co-fibrations and co-fibrant objects. This is something that we are going to do a little bit later. How do you describe the co-fibrations? Because how are they defined? They are defined using this lifting property. And typically, it's not easy to check when something has a lifting property like this. So we are going to do it for CDGAs, but in general, it's not a trivial question. So let's prove that this adjunction satisfies the hypothesis of the theorem. So we have this adjunction like this. I is Sn into Dn, J is 0 into Dn. All right. So let's check. I'm sorry, I forgot a condition in the theorem. U preserves sequential collimates. This is an extra stuff you need to check. All right, and strange condition, right? Because U is a right adjoint, so it preserves limits in general, not collimates. All right, so U preserves sequential collimates. Well, this is a media check. If you have a collection of CGGA like this, so these are not differentials, and these are each one of these is a CGGA, and you take A, which is the colimit of the AI, then you can check pretty easily that it will be the colimit in chain complexes, right? It's just some kind of union of all the AI. And in chain complexes, it will still be the union of the AI. Oh, well, not union direct sum, but you see what I mean. Okay. Well, of course, this one is satisfied because chain complexes is cofibrillatively generated. This one is satisfied. Just like in chain complexes, these are small objects. CDGA is complete and co-complete. We can compute limits and colimits in CDGA. So we are only left with checking this condition. And as I said, we are going to check this one because the other one is more tricky. So we need to check that well, for all x, y in J, A into A Fy is in WC. So in our case, we need to check that for all n in N and for all CDGA A, we map from A into A tensored with S of Gn of Q over S of Sn of Q is a quasi-iso. All right, if you translate what is written here, you have to take the push out of CDGAs. Sorry. And the push out is given by this tensor product. All right. So you take A and you map it, you include it inside A tensor, this tensor product, where we have a push out like this A of Sn of Q. We have something like this. Oh, yes. Sorry. There is nothing here. You are right. Of course, this is just zero. So we are looking, in fact, at the co-product in CDGAs. Sorry about that. So we are looking at this co-product in CDGA, which is just the tensor product in CDGA. We need to check that the inclusion of A into the tensor product like this is a quasi-isomorphism, right? A is mapped to A tensor one. But this follows pretty easily from the QNF isomorphism. The cohomology of A tensor S of Dn of Q is isomorphic to the cohomology of A tensored cohomology of S of Dn of Q. All right. Maybe I will do it below. Okay, but what is what is this complex? As a vector space, so it's a bit similar to what we saw before. Let's write that Dn of Q is Qx for right, in degree n minus 1, qy for star equals n, and 0 otherwise. So this is just the name of the generator, and d of x is y. All right, as a vector space, we have this. In degree star, we have one generator in degree n minus 1, one generator in degree y, and nothing elsewhere. And the differential simply maps this generator to this generator. So what does it become? Well, we have two cases depending on if n is even or odd. So let's say, for example, n is odd, then s of dn of q is given as a vector space by 1, x, y, x square, y, sorry, no y square, xy, x square y, x cube y, and so on. Because if n is odd, then this is even and this is odd. And the differential will kill this. It will do it like this. I should have swapped these two. Like this, right? If you compute d of x n y, you find that it is a sum of several terms. You find x times blah 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 times dx times blah 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 times x times y, and dy is zero. And so in the end, you find n minus one x n minus one y. What did I say? There is no y. All right. So for example, d of x is y. N minus one is only on the power. This is n x minus one y. All right. So dx is y. Dx square is yes, you are right, of course. This is also, I'm writing down an explicit proof, but there is a much simpler proof. You are right, the cohomology of S of dn of q is the symmetric algebra on the cohomology of dn of q, but it's pretty clearly acyclic here, right? This is acyclic, so this is just q in degree one, all right? And so if we go back to what we were trying to prove, I guess this is just another nice example of a quasi of a free CDGA. If we go back to what we were trying to prove, we were trying to prove that this is a quasi isomorphism, but clearly, like, this one is just q in degree one in cohomology, in degree zero, sorry, in cohomology. And you can check pretty easily that this is representative for the generators. All right, so A into A tensor S of dn of Q is quasi isomorphic. Right, this has the same cohomology as this, because this one is trivial in cohomology, and by the Cunier formula, we don't have like a tor or something like this. Okay, and as you can see, this again depends very much on the fact that we are over a field of characteristic zero. Otherwise, we have a lot of issues. All right. So any questions? No? Bon. So this proves that there is a model structure on CDGAs where weak equivalencies are quasi-isos and vibrations are surjections. I'm not going to prove this theorem. It's not very complicated. The proof is in my notes. There are only three axioms that are difficult to check. The lifting axiom, when you want to lift a cofibration against an acyclic fibration, because by definition, when you want to lift acyclic cofibrations against vibrations, because the other one is by definition, and you want to do the factorization axioms. Well, for both cases, pretty much you use the small object argument using the cofibrant generators here. You just apply F to them and you get your lifting and your factorizations. All right. If you want the complete proof, it's in my notes. Right. And maybe someone I can also add is that just to help you prove this theorem, essentially, C is cofibrantly generated by F of I and F of J, right? Almost by definition, but it's good to write it down explicitly. C will be cofibrantly generated by these generators. All right. So just to give you some idea of what's going on. So in our case, CDGA is cofibrantly generated by I, which is S of Sn of Q into S of Dn of Q, and J is zero into S of Dn of Q. So it's pretty interesting to look at these generating cofibrations. So we know that any cofibration, so let's focus on cofibration. For acyclic cofibrations, we have something similar. Any cofibration is a retract of a cellular I-cell complex. So essentially any cofibration can be obtained by pushing out along such maps. So what do push out along this map look like? Because our goal, as I said, will be to describe cofibrant objects explicitly. So what does it look like to push out against such a morphism? You have S of Sn of Q. This is what I was writing earlier, but which was wrong. So this is S of J, S of I, and this is some map F, and you have a pushout. A tensor S of Dn of Q, S of Sn of Q. Well, this map F is defined on a free CDGA, so by adjunction, it's completely determined by F restricted to Sn of Q. And what is F restricted to Sn of Q? Well, it is a map from Sn of Q, a cochain map into A. So what is Sn? It's just Q concentrated in degree N. So you send the generator, let's call it Y in degree N like before. You have to send it to F of Y, which has to be an element of An, such that D of F of Y is zero. All right, because it has to be a cochain map. And what is this map I? Well, you have to add a new variable. So this is s of yn. This is s of xn minus 1 yn, what I was writing before, with dx is y. So in this pushout, a prime, what you do is you add two new variables. Like this. You add two new variables, x and y, but you identify the y with f of y. So you are actually only adding x, and you add it such that d of x is y. So if you write f of y to be some alpha, I don't know, then this is isomorphic to a times s of x n minus 1 with dx is alpha. So this is what push out along generating cofibrations look like. You add a new variable x because the other one is identified with something in A, and this new variables has a differential which is in A and which is a cocycle. Well, it has to be a cocycle, otherwise d square is not zero. So this can do two different things. Either alpha equals zero, and therefore this adds a new cohomology class, which is just the class of X, because dx is zero, so it's a new class. Or alpha is non-zero, and then this kills the cohomology class of alpha, which is a cocycle. So push out along generating cofibrations can do one of two things. Either they can add a new cohomology class, or they can kill a cohomology class that already exists. All right, if you write down the details, this is what it does. And if you think about topological spaces, this is pretty much the same idea. When you glue a disk along a sphere, this can do two things. Either you are gluing along something which is null homotopic, so you are actually wedging a sphere, and you add a new class. Or you glue along some n minus 1 sphere, and you kill it in the cohomology or the homotopy. And there is really this parallel between well, what you do in the topology and what you do in the algebra. All right. Now the pushouts along the generating acyclic cofibrations, they do the same thing, except that you don't have this identification with y here. So you just add two new variables and one kills the other. So you don't change the cohomology. This is what we proved before. But well, this is what generating acyclic cofibrations look like. Okay. So very briefly in the 15 minutes that are left, what we are going to do is to describe cofibrant objects. So objects which are retracts of such cellular complexes. So this is called, I don't know, I call it Sullivan theory. So as I mentioned at the beginning, the rational homotopy theory we are seeing now is due to Sullivan. There is a kind of dual one, which is due to Quillen, but I'm not going to talk about. All right. So now we stick to CDGAs. So, and also something that I should mention, we are going to describe cofibrant objects. All CDGAs are fibrant, right? Everything surjects onto zero, which is the terminal CDGA. All right. So what are the cofibrant objects? So they are this. A Sullivan algebra is a quasi-free CGGA. So is it on CGGA or CGGA up? No, this is a CGGA. CGGA up will be later when we do the simply solved set stuff. But for now, it's just CGGA. For Quillen, no. Quillen theory is not for the opposite of CGGA. It's for DG Lie algebra. It's not dual in the sense of opposite category. It's dual in the sense of causal duality, which is, it's a very interesting field of mathematics, but we clearly don't have the time to go into this in 2 hours and 10 minutes. If you want, there are some references in my notes about this at the end of the chapter, if you are interested, it's a very interesting subject. It's not because it's not interesting that I don't talk about it, it's because I don't have the time. All right. So a Sullivan algebra is a quasi-free CGGA. So you have some graded vector space of generators and you have some differential, which is completely determined by what happens to the generators, such that, V is generated in degree at least one. Okay, so we don't deal with non-connected stuff, and later we will not even deal with non-simply connected stuff. So this is the first condition. V is filtered. So you have a filtration like this, V of zero, included in V of one, included in V of two, included in V, which is the union of Vn. Okay. Such that the differential maps V of zero to zero. And it maps Vn into, so a priori, the differential is defined on generators and it sends the generator to some product of elements in V. And it can be any product. And here we ask that the product only involves terms that are lower in the filtration. Okay. I will give an example, but just before the example, a relative Sullivan algebra is, it's not an algebra at all, it's a morphism. Like this. Such that, you have the same conditions, V is generated in degree one, a filtration. And the differential of an element which is in Vn. In principle, an element of V is sent to an element of A times the product of elements of V. And here you ask that it's an element of A times something which is lower in the filtration. All right, examples. So the cohomology of S of Dn of Q and S of Sn of Q are Sullivan. Algebras. All right, because for this one it's obvious. You just have one generator and the differential is zero. So okay, there is nothing to check. For this one, you can. So this is S of x, y with dx is y. You can filter like this. You take v, which is x, y, can be filtered by v of 0, which is y, and v of 1 is x, y. And you see that the differential of an element here is 0. And the differential of an element here is a product of elements lower in the filtration. Because, well, the differential of this is 0, and the differential of this can be expressed only in terms of y. So this is a Sullivan algebra. You have a filtration of the generators where you only go lower in the filtration when you apply the differential. Similarly, S of Sn of Q into S of Dn of Q is a relative Sullivan algebra. Okay, because, well, the only generator you need to add is X, and the differential of X doesn't involve X or its products. It only involves elements of the algebra from before. Another example, you take S of X, Y, and you take D of X is Y square. And here you have a filtration where in the first filtration, you have only Y, and in the second filtration, you have X and Y, and the differential of an element here only involves elements lower in the filtration. An example which is not a Sullivan algebra is the following. You take three generators, X, Y, Z, and you have D of X is Y, Z, D of Y is Z, X, and DZ is X, Y, right? And now you cannot find the filtration such that the differential only involves the term lower in the filtration. Because, well, if you want, for example, to take X and Y, then you have to add the Z because D of X is Y, Z. So you have an issue, right? You see, you cannot filter such that the differential of something is lower in the filtration because the differential of all the three elements involves terms in the lower in the filtration. Okay. Good for everyone. All right, so there is a proposition which is well, only a restatement of something that you know. A CDGA A. Oh, so this is the article, this is the algebra, and this is CDGA. Is a cofibrant if and only if it is a retract. CDGA such that A0 is Q, because I don't want to deal with non-connected stuff. It is a retract of a Sullivan algebra. And a morphism A to B, where A0 is equal to B0 is equal to Q, is a cofibration if and only if it is relative Sullivan algebra. And the proof is simply that well, cofibrations are retracts of cellular cell complexes like this. Right. Because with the description I gave earlier of a push out along these maps, whenever you do a push out along this map, you can filter as a Sullivan algebra, because when you add a new element, it will be higher in the filtration. right? And the element alpha will be lower in the filtration because it's in A. So whenever you add a new element like this, you only go lower in the filtration for the differential, right? So in one direction, it's clear that a cellular S of I complex is a Sullivan algebra, and the reverse is also true, because when you have a filtration like this, you just take a basis, linear basis of V0, then you extend it into a linear basis of V1, and the differential of the elements you had to add to your basis to make a basis of V1, their differential can only belong to V0 by definition of a Sullivan algebra. So they are all obtained by pushouts of the form of V4. You add new elements, which were like this. You add a new element X, such that dx is alpha, where alpha is from V4. Okay, then for V2, you extend it to a basis of V2. The new elements have a differential which is in V1, so the pushout is indeed of a form like this. You add a new variable which is your basis element of V2, and you have d of this element is some alpha which is in the filtration of V4, and so on. All right, this is a bit quick, but I hope the idea is clear. I just want to get to one last thing before we stop. A Sullivan algebra is minimal if, well, you have A, which is S of V, D, V is the union of Vn. The differential of an element is not just expressed in terms of elements which are lower in the filtration, but it's expressed, so I will explain the notation, as products of at least two terms. So you cannot have linear terms in the differentials. Right? So this is a notation to mean that this is, well, is this essentially. All right, you have products of at least two terms in every summand of the differential. Okay, so examples, well, this one is not minimal, because here it's not a product of at least two terms, this y, it's just one term. Whereas this one is minimal, because the differential of x is lower in the filtration and it's a product of at least two terms, it's a square, right? Okay. All right. And so we get to the theorem, which is a pretty powerful theorem to Sullivan minimal algebras. And this is, you will be shocked when you see this theorem, are quasi isomorphic if and only if they are isomorphic. So two minimal algebras are quasi-isomorphic if and only they are actually isomorphic. So of course, one direction of this implication is pretty trivial. The other is a bit more difficult. It's not that complicated. The proofs are explained in my notes, but essentially you work by induction. If you have a quasi-iso, so because they are cofibrant, if they are weakly equivalent, then there is a direct weak equivalence like this. And well, using the filtration, you can work by induction. First, you show that V0 is isomorphic to W0, then V1 is isomorphic to W1, and so on. and you use the fact that any differential decomposes as a product, which essentially means that whenever you add a new element, you cannot kill in cohomology an element from before. You can only kill products of elements. Right. It's a bit complicated to prove. It's a bit technical, but it's doable. Just combinatorics. All right. So just one final definition, and then I promise this is over. A minimal. Model of a CDG is a minimal CDG which is quasi isomorphic to it. All right, so just to explain to you briefly what we are going to do Friday. So minimal CDGAs are going to be the cofibrant objects of a subcategory of the CDGA, essentially when you take simply connected ones. And so therefore, this will be cofibrant resolution of your CDGA. And by what we have proved, well, not proved, but stated here, cofibrant models will be unique up to isomorphism, which is very strong, right? It's not just up to weak equivalence, it's up to isomorphism. And so this will give you a very nice description of the category and of the homotopy category. And then what we are going to briefly talk about is how to prove, well, not briefly, but I'm not going to prove it in full, but this subcategory will be Quillen equivalent to some subcategory of simply solved sets up to rational homotopy theory. And this will give you a lot of very nice results about rational homotopy theory. All right. So just to tell you what's going to happen Friday. So are there any questions before? So two questions. Did you have drawing to describe example of CDGA? Sorry, I don't really understand. So let me just answer the second question first. Yes, minimal algebra. Actually, a minimal algebra are by definition solvable algebra. There is another definition of minimal algebra that you can find in the literature, but in the context of simply connected algebras, they are equivalent, they are automatically solvable. So for this course, we will say that minimal algebras are automatically solvable. The other question, I don't really understand. A picture to describe an example of CDG. But it's more of an algebraic thing, but really the image you could have in mind is whenever you have a generator, you can think of it as some kind of sphere and push outs, so tensor products along some other things will be like gluing spheres along elements. So for example, this CDGA, what is it? Well, you start from some Y, which is of degree N, and then you add some X, such that the boundary of X is Y. So you glue a disk along this sphere. Here, what is this? Well, it's a bit more complicated to describe because you have this square, but I won't try to draw a picture of this because it's too complicated, but it's difficult to draw pictures of algebraic things, but I don't really see what in braid. What do you mean in braid? Sorry, I don't really understand. You mean like in braiding monoidal categories? Well, one way to think about this is that you have a symmetric monoidal structure on CDGAs, which is given by the tensor product. And you have this permutation of terms. But here, they are not really braids because it's not just braided monoidal categories. When you swap things, if you square it, you get the identity. So, right, if you do something like this or something like this, it's the same. Right, essentially because minus one square is one, the identity. So you can introduce some braids, but they don't really do anything more than just symmetric actions. Yes. All right, so are there any other questions? I see that some people are starting to leave, so I guess it's a good time to stop the recording.